weapons. They're pretty sick, huh? While you do see weapons like swords and guns and others in other media like video games and movies, anime and manga never fail to surprise me with the different type of weapons they have and how they go about using them. The movie Sword of the Stranger has my favorite sword fight of all time. While it might not be my favorite when it comes to emotion, when it comes to the storyboarding, the choreography and fluidity of it, it is such a freaking treat to look at, dude. When you hear guns in anime, you probably think of Cowboy Bebop or Black Lagoon. Can't blame you, they're probably two of the most popular choices. And of course, it isn't just swords and guns that I'm talking about here. You have chain weapons, pole weapons, and some other pretty unorthodox weapons that we will get into in this video. So, hey, traveler, if any of what I just said seemed interesting to you at all, then I think it'd be pretty cool if, you know, stop here for a bit, take a rest, regain your energy, you know? So if you decided to stay, sick. Thanks so much for chilling out with us, and let's talk about some freaking weapons, dude. So while writing this and having to pick where to start, I decided to start with the one you're probably going to see the most in anime and manga. I think you can guess what I'm talking about. The type of sword you'll see the most in anime is a katana, a sword with a curved single-edged blade, with either a circular or squared guard and a long grip for two hands. But some characters only use one hand because, well, that's just how they are. I don't know if this is just me, but the first person I think of when I think of a katana is Jin from Samurai Champloo. Made an entire video on Samurai Champloo, you should go watch it. Stories you will commonly see characters wielding katanas are those based in the time period of the samurai, a fantasy world, or a more modern urban setting. I think between these three, my favorites are definitely the first and third. First one being because I'm a humongous fan of samurai and sword fighters, and the third one because seeing a character in a modern and more urban setting wielding a katana or any sword for that matter is just badass as hell. And I just want to highlight one of my favorite swords in anime, wielded by one of my favorite characters in anime, Mugen. This sword is a double-edged tsurugi with a two-prong hilt, and this sword fits his fighting style perfectly. Mugen is a very unorthodox and unpredictable fighter. His fighting style is based on breakdancing called Champloo Kendo. This fighting style is his creation, taking bits and pieces of martial arts and making up the rest on the go as he fights his opponents. He's an instinctual fighter, and this makes him a force to be reckoned with. The examples I've given so far are more grounded in reality, but what if we explore the supernatural? Swords with supernatural abilities in anime and manga are a dime a dozen. I'm just sitting here trying to think of all the examples I could give, and I can't name them all. Swords made of fire, swords made of ice, swords made of ether, and so on and so forth. But when I think about swords with supernatural abilities, the first ones that come into mind are Bleach and the Fate series. I mean, these are two of my favorite stories of all time. Is that biased? Probably. I don't give a flying fuck. In Fate, you have historical figures using legendary weapons that they are known for. Saber, aka Arthur, aka Artoria Pendragon, of course wields the legendary sword Excalibur, an extremely beautiful and powerful sword which has immense destructive power, especially when she unleashes her noble phantasm. This might be understatement of the century, but Fate has an absolutely immense cast of characters. Well, Tite Moon in general. So there are plenty of characters that have supernatural weapons, not even just talking about swords anymore. Keep that in mind, we'll probably come back to Fate later. Of course, I can say the exact same thing about Bleach. Humongous cast of characters with their own unique abilities. The Zanpakuto the Shinigami wield are unique to the user and are imperative to understanding them as characters. They have their Shikai release and their
Bankai.
If this video was just focused on swords, if I really, really wanted to, I could dive deep into this topic about swords. But I have at least two more weapon types I want to talk about that could also be pretty lengthy conversations. So I think it's about time we moved on to... Guns are definitely the second weapon type you'll see the most in anime, whether they be traditional guns or a unique type for that story. Pistols, machine guns, snipers, you name it. I think either pistols or snipers are my favorite type of guns. Biased, you decide to ask? Probably. There are four stories that come to mind when thinking of firearms in anime. Black Lagoon, of course, Jormungand, Kanan, and Cowboy Bebop. Seeing the way firearms are depicted in anime, and kind of just animation in general, it's always so fascinating and so damn cool to me. There are certain cuts where they show a character reloading a gun or completely taking apart a gun and cleaning it and just maintaining it. Like, look at this. This is dope as shit. It probably goes without saying, but Cowboy Bebop has some of the best gunfights you'll ever see. You'll be sitting there watching these beautiful, thrilling action scenes while probably, as my grandma used to say, getting down to the sick-ass jazz music. I swear to God, all of these anime freaking deserve a video of their own. Black Lagoon is the definition of chaos, and I love it for it. It's so freaking brutal, dude. And because of the hard work of the animation staff, they make all of this brutality look beautiful. This anime has one of my favorite characters of all time. A character that I love, a character that I'm genuinely terrified of, and that I feel so sorry for.
Both of these are just things. As soon as you strip away their meanings, then that's all they really are. Just things, nothing more. And if you're gonna give these things any kind of meaning again, they won't get any of their value because they're someone's precious memory. Their value will be determined by the one thing everybody agrees on. And that's money.
Again, they need their own video. I can say the same thing about Jormungand and Kanan. Yeah, all four of the series definitely need a rewatch. There are so many amazing gunfights in anime, and trying to decide what my favorite is, it's really damn hard. But if I had to say what my favorite gunfight in anime is, well, let me ask you something first. Have you heard of gun kata? Gun kata is a firearm-based martial art invented by Kirk Wimmer and Jim Vickers in their 2002 film, Equilibrium. It's literally gun fu. This is the definition of rule of cool, and I love it for that. I personally have never seen Equilibrium. I mean, the movie came out a year before I was born, but I hear it's a cult classic, especially in Japan. Other works saw this and decided to copy the fighting style and put it into their own stories. And that, of course, includes anime. I think the most well-known gun kata fight in anime is the one between Homura and Mami from Madoka Magica. Still haven't seen Madoka yet, I definitely need to watch it. But my favorite gun kata fight in anime, and I think just my favorite gunfight in general, there's a lot of great ones. Toss up, my opinion could change tomorrow. But my favorite gunfight, as of right now, is... Bungo Stray Dogs. Not only does Bungo Stray Dogs have so many phenomenal fights, but it has so many phenomenal moments, just period. This definitely being one of them. Oda Saku versus Andre. The animation staff murdered this. This is some god-tier shit.
I'm not gonna dive into the plot of this fight because you should definitely go watch this freaking anime, but when it comes to the action, the effects animation, the choreography, the storyboarding, the intensity of the battle.
I haven't seen anything like this in an anime. The only thing I think comes close is Homura vs. Mami, but that's kind of its own thing. It has its own unique flair to it. This, especially when you have context of what the hell is going on, it is such a phenomenal freaking fight. And when it comes to showcasing guns in animation in general, this is most definitely, in my opinion, one of the best examples I could give. I absolutely love it.
On your own, baby. But
you said we'd be together.
I think I have about two more sections of weapons and anime that I want to talk about. It was originally going to be like maybe four, heck, even five more. No, I'm not kidding. But when it comes to the next category, I decided to just combine them into one because when it comes to the two I was originally going to separate, there are times when those two weapons are actually the same weapon. You don't understand a word I'm saying. You'll see what I mean. I guess I'll just call this category fucking, I don't know, miscellaneous. We've done guns. We've done swords. The next example of weapons I'm going to give are the kind of weapons that you won't see as much as guns and swords, but won't really shock you too much if you do see them. This might be recency bias, but when I think of an anime character using an axe, I think of Hyome. And like I mentioned before, his weapon is a combination. He wields an axe attached to a chain attached to a freaking spike ball. God damn, does he know how to use that shit. Well, watching him go off against Muzan was freaking phenomenal. And you know what, screw it, since we're already talking about chains, Kurapika is one of my favorite characters of all time, in anime, fiction, period. When I think of characters using chains as a weapon, Kurapika is the first person that pops into mind. And I think a lot of other people's minds as well. This fight against Uvogin was absolutely amazing and showed just how much dedication he had to completing his goal. Seeing his chains in action was just so freaking cool, dude. I know another character that I think of when talking about chains is... I told you we would come back to Fate. Ryder, aka Medusa. One of my favorite servants that really shines so bright in Heaven's Field. I think as a collective, we were all losing our damn minds when we saw her and Shiro against Saber in the third movie. Just god tier. God tier shit, bro. The storyboarding, the choreography, and the key animation by all those talented gods at Ufotable. The blade chain she uses whenever she fights is nothing like I've seen before in any media. Every time she came on screen to fight, I was always wondering how she would go about using them. And the way she used them was really freaking sick. After seeing her in action, her weapon of choice definitely became one of my favorites. The next weapon type I'm going to talk about are pole weapons. And hey, since I'm already talking about Fate, you already know who I'm going to talk about next. Lancer, aka Kukualin. When it comes to Lance users slash pole users, he's probably my favorite one. Any fight that Ku was a part of lives in my head rent-free. Another character that comes to mind when it comes to pole-type weapons is Ruby Rose. I definitely need to rewatch Ruby one day. I know her weapon is a scythe, but it still counts. Ruby also has a gun built into her scythe, so she can also be a long-range fighter and or do cool-ass shit like this.
Talking about this shit means something to me.
The Ruby series definitely have some of the most coolest weapons I've seen like ever, and all of them are pretty freaking unorthodox. Keep what I just said in mind. Going back to Ku, he wields the immensely powerful and legendary spear, the Gay Bulk. Not gonna lie, bro, this is like probably top 10 favorite weapons for me in Fate. Scratch that, Type Moon in general. His first fight against Archer was just a taste of his high level of proficiency at wielding this weapon. The way he just effortlessly swings it around is just so cool to watch. And of course, his Noble Phantasm, like every other Noble Phantasm in the series, is freaking beautiful to witness every time. His second fight against Archer and his fight against Assassin are probably tied as my favorite fight from Lancer. They are both so amazing. Go watch Fate. There are a lot of weapons, a lot of fucking weapons that I could still mention. I have some in mind, you probably have some in mind, but we would be here all freaking day. So, for the last section of this weapon deep dive, I guess, I want to talk about some weapons that you really don't see often, if at all. Weapons that might make you think, do they even count as weapons? Weapons that are just completely and utterly unorthodox. You saw the thumbnail. And for those of you who know who the hell this dude is, first of all, I love you. Second of all, you've probably been waiting for me to start talking about him. And yeah, not gonna lie, this entire section is just gonna be focused on him and two more characters that are also pretty freaking unorthodox. If you decide upon yourself to take a trip to Ikebukuro, you'll probably run into a man by the name of Chizuo Heiwajima, the strongest man in Ikebukuro. You see this man use a plethora of weapons, anything he can get his hands on. Other than just using his hands to kick ass, he will pick up a whole ass vending machine and chuck it at you. He will pick up a stop sign and try to whack the shit out of you with it. He will drag a stop sign on the ground to create rubble and then throw it at you. And by you, I mainly mean Isaiah and anyone else who pisses him off. Just don't piss him off. Don't piss him off. He is the definition of superhuman. And every time he gets hurt, he comes back strong. This man picked up a whole ass street direction sign, sliced off the top of a car, and then chucked it at them. I'm fucking done. That's not even all the examples I could give. And get this shit, Get this. All of what I just said, that was just in the first season. Yep. This anime has like 4 seasons in total. That was all in the first motherfucking season. The first one. I'm not kidding. There are 3. Other seasons, and he did that in the first season. I cannot stress that enough. So yeah, do you see why I say this dude is pretty freaking unorthodox? Who else do you know is doing this? I'm actually struggling to think of anyone else that could emulate what Shizuo does. Oh.
最強の殺し屋がいた。 その名は 坂本太郎。
So, everything I said about Shizuo, Taro Sakamoto could easily do or has already done it. Using a cough drop to deflect a bullet, using rubber bands like bullets, oh wow, even using a street sign, sound familiar, to stop a bus. Using a cooking pot to knock someone the fuck out, using a frying pan to shatter their whole ass weapon, and then slamming a whole ass refrigerator on someone. All of what I just said was in the first volume of the manga. Need I go on? I think not. Shizuo Heiwajima and Taro Sakamoto. These two are the definition of superhuman. They are both extremely adaptive and will use anything and everything they can get their hands on. These two are anomalies. And when it comes to using weapons in anime, these two, you guessed it, are completely unorthodox. I bet even they don't know what they'll get their hands on next. There are plenty of weapons that I didn't mention. Plenty of weapons that I realistically couldn't mention. There's too many. There's way too goddamn many. But that is the beauty of fiction and fantasy. So many awesome, cool, and creative ideas that come out of anime, manga, and of course, other pieces of media as well. And to be honest, it's pretty hard to pinpoint what my favorite type of weapon is. So, I'll ask you instead. What's your favorite? I, once again, really appreciate you for taking the time to stop at this checkpoint and take a rest. Life can be a lot sometimes, and I really hope that this, at least a little bit, made your day a bit better. If you would like to support my passion and make this checkpoint your second home, you could do so by joining my Patreon for as little as $2. You get videos like this much earlier than they appear on YouTube, and you have your name at the end of every future video. There's other tiers and even better perks such as exclusive videos only seen on Patreon. You gain the power to vote for future videos and sneak peeks of upcoming projects. You also can become a channel member for $1, where you also have your name at the end of every future video and gain access to my exclusive emojis. But of course, that is only if you're inclined to do so. Just you being here, stopping by, spending time with us, that truly is and always will be a blessing, and I'm forever grateful. I've taken up enough of your time, and I know you gotta get back to, you know, life and shit. So, with all that being said, have yourself a damn good one, and safe travels.